If you are using or want to use interrupts in your Arduino programs, well, that's fine. But before you do so, you need to be aware of some limitations and best practices, otherwise this could mess your program up. In this tutorial, I'm going to show you 5 important things to know when writing Arduino interrupts. First point, if you modify a variable inside an interrupt, then you should declare this variable as volatile. So as you can see here, I use shouldMoveMotor inside the interrupt function here, triggerMoveMotor that was declared here with attachInterrupt. And so this should be volatile. The compiler does many things to optimize the code and the speed of the program. This is a good thing, but here we need to tell it to slow down on optimization. For example, if the compiler sees a variable declaration, but the variable is not used anywhere in the code, except from interrupt, it may completely remove that variable. With a volatile variable, you are safe and the variable will be stored anyway. Also, when you use volatile, it tells the controller to reload the variable whenever it is referenced here. Sometimes the compiler will use copies of variables to go faster. Here you want to make sure that every time you access and modify the variable, either in the main program or inside an interrupt, you get the real variable and not a copy. Note that only variables that are used inside and outside an interrupt here should be declared as volatile. You don't want to unnecessarily slow down your code. Point number 2, an interrupt function can't take any parameter and it doesn't return any value. As you can see here, with the trigger move motor, you have void data type and no parameter. So if you have to write a prototype for an interrupt, this will be always void, name of a function, and then parentheses without parameters. And thus, the only way to share data with the main program is through global volatile variables like this one. In an interrupt, you can also get and set data from hardware pins as long as you keep the program very short. For example, you could use digital read or digital write. That would be okay, but just don't abuse it and don't do it if it's not necessary. Point number 3, keep the interrupts fast. As you can guess, you should make the interrupt function as fast as possible. Why is that? Simply because it stops the main execution of your program. So if you are inside this function here, everything else is paused. Okay, so don't do heavy computation here. And also one thing to know is that only one interrupt can be handled at a time. So if you have different interrupts, just one at a time will be triggered. What I recommend you to do is to only change a state for variables inside interrupt functions. Okay, just like we do here with a Boolean variable, which is also volatile. In the main loop here, you check for those state variables and do any required computation or action. Okay, the move motor here can be quite heavy computation, but that's fine because it's in the loop function. And so here you can see what we do with the flag. So we set a flag. So when I say flag, I mean Boolean. Okay, that's the same. So we set the flag as false here, and whenever the interrupt function is called, we set the flag as true. And then in the void loop, we keep monitoring the flag. If this is true, we execute the action, and of course, we set the flag to false. So we need to come back to the interrupt again, so we can do the action again. Okay, so that is very important. If you don't keep the interrupt fast, you are going to miss important deadlines in your code. Okay, and as a real life example, if you have, let's say, a mobile robot with 2 wheels that you control from the Arduino, that may make the motor movement kind of jerky. For communication between devices, you might miss some data, etc., etc. Okay, and when you need to deal with real-time constraints, this rule becomes even more important. Point number 4, how to use time functionalities inside interrupts. And so here the basic rule of thumb is don't use time functionalities in your interrupt, with just maybe one exception. Here are more details about the 4 main time functions here that we have. So first you have the millis function. OK, Okay, this will return the time spent since the Arduino program has started in milliseconds. This function relies on some other interrupts to count, and as you are inside an interrupt, all the other interrupts are actually not running. So if you use millis at the beginning of the interrupt or just in the interrupt, you will get the last stored value, which will be correct. Okay, that's going to be the time when you read the interrupt. But after that, in the interrupt, the value of millis will never increase. So that is actually the exception, is you can do this at the beginning of the interrupt if you ever need that value, but then that's it. Don't ever use it again in the interrupt. The same for micros, okay? So you may get the time with millis or micros at the beginning and that's it. Then we have the delay function. And this one will simply not work. And plus, even if it was possible, you should not use it because you now know that you have to keep the interrupt very fast. So don't intentionally wait inside an interrupt, right? And then, well, so you have the delay microseconds also, which, so this delay microseconds is going to work, but same thing, don't use it because you just don't want to stay long inside an interrupt, okay? You just want to enter, change one flag or two, and then just leave. Okay, so you may want to change some flag depending on the time, okay, depending on the current time and maybe a previous time you have stored, okay? So that is the only way to use time functionalities inside an interrupt. And note that this, well, if you want to read the time in an interrupt, you can also do this in the void loop, okay? You can just change a flag to say, yeah, the interrupt has been called, and then in the void loop, you can use time functionalities to check stuff and decide if you want to do an action or not. And point number five, don't use serial in the interrupt. The serial library is very useful to debug and communicate between your Arduino board and other boards or devices, but it's not a great fit for interrupt functions. When you are inside an interrupt, the received serial data may be lost. And thus, it's not a good idea to use the reading functionalities of serial. Also, if you make the interrupt too long and read from serial after that in your main code, well, you may still have lost some parts of the data. So once again, keep interrupts fast. Then you can use serial print in the interrupt for debugging, but just maybe, for example, if you are not sure that this interrupt has been triggered, okay, you just want to test once and then that's it and you remove it, okay? Because it also has its own sources of problem. So use it just to debug if you are not sure about something, but then in your real program that is going to run, don't use serial. Now, the best way to print something from an interrupt is actually not to print from the interrupt, but to set a flag inside the interrupt, like we do here, and then poll this flag inside the main loop program. And when the flag is turned on, you print something. So if you want to print this, you can just print it there or any other text you want. And doing that will simply save you from many potential headaches. To conclude, knowing those 5 points is super important whenever you want to work with Arduino interrupts. If you respect all the rules and best practices from this video, you should not have any problem with your interrupt. So if you modify your global variable, make it volatile. Don't put any parameter or return type for your interrupt functions. Keep the interrupt very fast. If you need to do something that takes time, do it in the void loop instead. Then be careful with time functionalities. And most importantly, don't wait inside the interrupt. And finally, don't use the serial communication inside the interrupt. If you liked this video, subscribe to get more tutorials like this in the future. Also, check out my online courses so you can learn Arduino step by step in an efficient way by practicing and directly going to the point. Links in the description. Alright, thank you for watching. See you in the next tutorial or in one of my courses.